نحمده ونشكره ونستعين به جل وعلا ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ به سبحانه وتعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. عباد الله، أنصحكم ونفسي الآثمة بتقوى الله، وأحثكم وإياها على طاعته، وأحذركم وإياها وبال مخالفته جل وعلا ومعصيته. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ولا شيء مثله، ولا شيء قبله، ولا شيء يعجزه، قديم بلا ابتداء، دائم بلا انتهاء، لا يفنى ولا يبيد، ولا يكون إلا ما يريد، لا تبلغه الأوهام ولا تدركه الأفهام، ولا يشبه الأنام، حي لا يموت، قيوم لا ينام، سبحانه لا مثل له ولا مثال له ولا مثيل له ولا مماثل له. ذلك بأن ربنا جل وعلا موصوف بصفات الوحدانية، منعوت بنعوت الفردانية، ليس في معلاه أحد من البرية. وأشهد أن سيدنا وسندنا وعظيمنا وشفيعنا وقرة أعيننا ونور أبصارنا وبصائرنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم، عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله، أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره الكافرون. صل اللهم وسلم على خير الورى ونور العلا وشمس الضحى وبدر الدجى، أعني الحبيب محمدا المصطفى، وصلي على آله الطيبين الطاهرين سادة الأنام وحماة بيضة الإسلام، موضحي حقائق الدين وقاهري أحزاب المفسدين وسهام من مرام الله على المنافقين، ورضي الله تبارك وتعالى عن صحابة رسول الله المخلصين المحسنين المتقين، لا سيما ساداتنا أبي بكر الصديق وعمر بن الخطاب الفاروق وجامع القرآن سيدنا عثمان بن عفان، وعن سيد الله الغالب أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب، وارض اللهم عن سائر السابقين الأولين من الأنصار والمهاجرين ومن اتبعهم بإحسان وتمسك بالثقلين إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، عباد الله، يقول الله جل وعلا، الله سبحانه وتعالى يقول في القرآن العظيم: فلا تعجبك أموالهم ولا أولادهم. The meaning of the ayah في سورة التوبة: Don't be fooled. لا تعجبك. You should not like fall for the trap of liking their أموال. أموال is from man. Their money. Lots of money. ولا أولادهم. And not all their children. Don't be fooled when you look at people. Meaning of the ayah, you look at people and say, SubhanAllah, amwal, so much money, so much offspring, so many numbers. Don't be fooled. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to what? Wants actually to give, to torture them with it. في الحياة الدنيا. وتزهق أنفسهم وهم كافرون. And then, not only that, in the day of judgment, they will die on this in this hayat dunya like this, and then they will be assembled kuffar. The meaning is to distinguish, not to look at things superficially. We look at things superficially all the time. And we sometimes get overtaken by the things that are said, or the things that appear to us. Al-Qur'an al-Azim is trying to tell us, no, wait a minute. You look at these money and you look at all these things, you think, this is it? No. take a deeper look and start analyzing. And that's why we mentioned many times in the Quran al-Azim, Allah always mentions what? أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ أَفَلَا يَعْقِلُونَ أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ أَمْ كُنْتُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ See that, all these things? تَذَكَّرْ الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض. Therefore, the Muslim must look at things from very number one balanced point of view and very what analytical point of view. Not take things at face value and then take them as such. And that's the blessing of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah رضي الله عنهم. Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the way they are distinguished among all the Muslim sects is by what? By being balanced. وكذلك جعلناكم أمة وسطا. لا إله ولا ولا لا شرقية ولا غربية. Not to this side and not to that side. Not extreme on one way and not extreme on the other way. And that's why the first two pillars of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah and their belief is what? Al-Qur'an wa Sahih al-Sunnah. Thank you, understand? Because otherwise what will happen? He says, she says, he said, he said, he said, he said. And then what happened? Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, فيما يروى عنه, says to the people of that time, you should, if it, almost I believe that the heaven will start sending what? Stones on you. I'm telling you, قال الله. I say, قال الله. وقال رسول الله. And you're telling me, قال أبو بكر وقال عمر. رضي الله عنهما أن يلا أبو بكر الصديق وعمر الخطاب رضي الله عنهما. Still, when you say, قال الله وقال رسول الله, ما كان لمؤمن ولا مؤمنة أن يكون لهم الخيارة من أمرهم. كذا قال الرسول. Today, we are with another personality of the household of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam, and with this, inshallah, today we will finish then the finishing of Sirat Imam Hussein ibn Ali, ruhi lahu al-fida wa radhiyallahu ta'ala alayhi. I'm going to take you to the last part of the scenario, and as you all know, now everyone was basically killed, slaughtered. The women and the children were spared at the beginning, and of course among them was the youngest one, the youngest surviving one, which is the only surviving one really. Zain al-Abidin, his name is Ali. His name is not Zain al-Abidin. Many people, they always say Zain al-Abidin. But really his name is not Zain al-Abidin, this was a title given to him. Zain al-Abidin was spared, and we will talk about why was he spared, for a reason. And he was not the youngest one of Imam Hussein's sons, as you all know. Abdullah al-Radiya, the infant, Abdullah was 6 months old, and he was also slaughtered. But before I go into the seerah of Imam Zain al-Abidin, and before we establish what his accomplishments were and what he contributed to the Sunnah and to the Quran of explanations and leadership, I have to say that the point is not when was Zain al-Abidin born, nor when was he killed, nor how many children he had, and who was he married to. These are simple historical things that one can assemble easily. The point is to learn what was the pathway of Zain al-Abidin. How did he behave, and how did he act, and what did he do to spread the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. And so, why do we want to learn that? So we know how we can be affected by him. So we know how we can be following his footsteps to the accurate, to the authentic sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi. This is the reason. The reason is not to get to know a personality for the personality itself, though the personality is great, but to know how can we be affected by such an esteemed personality among al-sunnah wal-jama'ah. Al-Imam Zain al-Abidin is very easy to know his life through the time and the place. Anyone's history can be governed by the time or the place. The time and the place. The place was of course after the battle of Al-Taf or after the battle of Karbala. That's really the area or the time, the period of time where Zain al-Abidin was distinguished, appeared. Because before that, before Karbala, before Taf, he was what? He was under the son of his father, Hussein ibn Ali. So after Imam Hussein was slaughtered, then of course who came to the picture was Zain al-Abidin, as the only surviving one from the offspring of Imam Hussein. And the way you know the time, I figured the best way you know about the time of people is by knowing the ruler of the people. Look at how the rulers are, you can tell how the people are and how the situation is really on the actual ground. And for example, when you look at the time of Sayyidina Abu Bakr, all you have to know that Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu warḍah was the Khalifa. There's adil, there's justice, there's all these things. When you learn about the seerah of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, all you have to know is that you can get there. You can talk and you can say this, you can say that. You know that there's law established. Same thing with the Khulafa Rashid radiallahu anhu. So therefore, the best way actually to know the situation on the ground is by knowing who was the ruler of that time, the ruler of the time. When Imam Zain al-Abidin appeared in the Islamic field, working always. He's always been working, but as alone, like I said, the ruler's name was Yazid bin Muawiyah bin Abi Sufyan. Allah. After Yazid came Muawiyah bin Yazid, Muawiyah Thani. Now this one's days were not long. Many historians said he was only for 2 months. And he said, you know, it's enough. I cannot deal with this. This is too much. Let me get out of it. Who got it? The other branch of Umayyah ibn Abi Ma'iq is Marwan ibn al-Hakam. So we started with Yazid ibn Muawiyah. Then Muawiyah ibn Yazid, this Muawiyah the second they call him. And then Marwan ibn al-Hakam. Marwan ibn al-Hakam. And then Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. And then Al-Walid ibn Abdul Malik. Those are the five that were actually dealing, and the Imam Zain al-Abidin lived through their time. And the reason I'm telling you these things, so you know what time, who was the ruler of that time, and who he lived under. And of course, when you read these things, actually you don't even need to read about them. All you have to read about the hadith, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions that the Khilafah of Nubuwa is 30 years. After 30 years, the Khilafah, prophetic style, will be gone. وَيَتْبَعُهَا مُلْكٌ عَضُوضًا مُلْكٌ ظَلُومٌ. Unjust people. If you really go into the seerah of Marwan ibn al-Hakam, وعبد الملك ibn Marwan, والوليد ibn عبد الملك, who ended up killing Imam Zain al-Abidin, you would see that these people really cared pretty much about the chair. Whatever keeps them in power is what matters. And actually the behavior throughout that time was pretty much the same way. As Suyuti wa Tabari and others narrate about, I'm going to give you some pictures to see what was the situation when Zain al-Abidin was living, so you see how the people were. Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan stands on the minbar fi Dimashq al-Sham in the Salat al-Jum'ah and says, Wallah, la ya'muruni ahadukum bi taqwallah. No one orders me to fear Allah, to have taqwa in Allah, illa kana as-sayfu asra'u ila 'unuqihi min kalimatihi la sam'i. Except if someone says, ittaqillah to me, the sword will be faster to his neck than his own words to his own ears. Faster. If you say something, you breathe wrong, and then not only you go, No, you will go, and your family will go, and then they will give you all kinds of labels immediately. Boom, label. Get them out of here. Khawarij, easiest thing to say, Khawarij. Al-Walid ibn Yazid, that's another one. Even though he's a late one from Bani Umayyah, from the rulers of Bani Umayyah, Hukam Bani Umayyah, but it tells you a picture, because most of them were the same pretty much, except few exceptions, you all know them. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, radiallahu ta'ala alayhi. الوليد بن يزيد ولو رواها الماوردي والدمري and others. والله if you read the history of this man you'll be ashamed that he was a ruler, he was amir, he was khalifa. This man, of course, drunk as usual. He goes, and Imam Mawardi says, he goes, he went into his palace one day, drunk, and he opened the Quran, يَتَطَيَّرُ بِهِ يَتَطَيَّرُ, he wants to see which ayah comes in the Quran first, and if it's good, then he'll feel better. If it's a tough ayah, nar or so, or punishment, then he will not do something. Opened the Quran, the first ayah came to him, وَخَابَ كُلُّ جَبَّارٍ عَنِيدٍ. And every jabbar, every tyrant, stubborn, will lose, shall lose, and will lose, definitely. He, of course, Imam Dimari al-Mawardi says he got very mad. Took the sahifa of Quran and tore it apart. And said these two poets, these lines, they're in the books. أَتُعِدُ كُلَّ جَبَّارٍ عَنِيدٍ. He's talking to the Quran. You're trying to threaten every jabbar aneed. وَهَا أَنَا ذَاكَ جَبَّارٌ عَنِيدٍ. And I am jabbar aneed. إذا ما جئت ربك يوم حشر فقل يا رب مسقني الوليد. If you are assembled in the day of حشر, then say, oh Allah, الوليد tore me apart. Drunk, okay, you can say he was drunk, so he's not accountable. Whatever excuses we can find, that's fine. Those are pictures I'm taking you through so you can see the kind of environment that the Muslims were living through. Under the very name, of course, of Islam, with Islamic leadership and Islamic rulership, etc., etc. The dictatorship went to its height. People sometimes think, and I said that before, that nowadays the Muslim rulers are dictators. The Muslim rulers are very much human today compared to what they were before. Very much. They haven't even got close to what they were. Why? Because when you realize that Yazid ibn Muawiyah, when he sent his army, with the leadership of Muslim bin Uqba al-Mirri. Of course, that's what historians call him, Muslim bin Uqba. His name is Muslim. Really, that's a misnomer. He should not be called Muslim bin Uqba. He should be called Musrif bin Aqaba. Musrif. What kind of Muslim would do this? With 100,000 people, to where? Where did do you think he was sent? To a Rome or La Paris? He was sent to the city of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, to al-Madinah al-Munawwara, ila madinati Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa ma'ahu 100,000 jundi min al-Sham. What is the problem? What is the need? Because Ahl al-Madinah tharu, the people of Medina, they revolted against Yazid. What do you mean? Fihum sahaba wa tabi'in. There are sahaba and tabi'in among them. They revolted. Yazid sent them an army filled with people. What was the mission of the army? The destruction of the Medina of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَهَذَا تَرَى not only narrated by Tabari والقرطبي, Tabari ibn Athir, also Ibn Kathir al-Mutakhirin, from the recent ones, etc. Everyone narrates these things. وَقْعَةِ الْحَرَّةِ is very much known. And as you know, the Suyuti said that 1,000 women were raped among the daughters of sahaba and tabi'in. That's different than 10,000 people that were killed. في حرة في مدينة رسول الله والبخاري ومسلم أهل الأسانيد والمجاميع والأحاديث they narrate that the ones what? The one who does harm to the مدينة of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم is cursed. What happens when the ruler is a dictator? What happens when there is no freedom? What happens when your freedom is taken away? And I will take you back to the time of the Khulafa al-Rashideen. When the women came, and I will say this again and again and again, so when the woman came to Umar radiallahu anhu, and she told him, Ya Umar, you are wrong, am I right? And he said, what did he say? أصابت المرأة وقطعها. Freedom. Freedom. You're free. As long as your objective, you are free to say, you are free to talk, you are free to negotiate. The reason is, we want to reach the truth. But when dictators come, and when it's only one way, what happens to Islam and Muslims? Muslims, they lose everything. You lose your creativity. If I butt you down with the sword, I put it on your head, you can't breathe, you can't talk, and I enslave you so you can go and barely work, so you can barely feed your children. What did I do to you? I enslaved you. I strip you away from your creativity. I strip you away from every ability that you can have. I strip you away from every advancement that you can reach. You can get nowhere. Don't think that people say Muslims are really behind. Muslims are intelligent people. But they are not given the opportunity. They are stripped away from all these things so they don't become creative. That's not a new policy. That's an old policy. Yazid did that at the beginning. An insan, my dear beloved, is like a flower. Flower, what are they? What does a flower need to prosper? It needs freedom. It needs air. It needs sunshine. An-nur, wal-hawa. If you take this flower and you put it in a deep place and you cover it up, no nur of shams, no nur of the sun comes, no air comes, and you put it in jail, you surround it from everywhere, what would happen to that flower? It will die. It will die. No other way. No other option. Why did Allah send the Rasul? Why did Allah send all these books? Why did Allah send the messages? So that a human being can live like a flower. So the human being can prosper and grow. So the human being can be creative to help his fellow human being. To help the cause of humanity. So the human being can give, can be creative, can advance. But if you take away all these things and you strip him away from every possibility, you're choking him. He's busy. The Muslims in the world, and especially Muslim countries, they're busy working day and night just to feed themselves, family. How can he think about anything else? And if he drops anything, his head will be chopped. Same thing. The policy of Yazid has not changed. It has been mellow very much. It's very mild now, but it's still there. And Imam Zain al-Abidin opened his eyes to see these pictures. Opened his eyes to see that the society is boiling. Cannot take anymore. Al-Khilafa Rashida was destroyed. Al-Hukm bil-Qur'an wa sunnah, ruling according to the Qur'an and authentic sunnah, was put aside. It came to a one-man role, one-man show. No more shura. Who's going to give shura? If you say, اتَّقِ اللَّهِ they will chop your head. What kind of shura? The shura is gone. All these things, some people still think, and some brother told me the other day, may Allah bless him, he said, you mentioned about Ahlul Bayt many times, though we mentioned about the Sahaba and we mentioned about the Khulafa Rashidun all the time, but because when you mention one time about Ahlul Bayt, then what happens? Everyone's get on fire. Says, is this an attempt to get Ahlul Sunnah close to the Shia? No. It's an attempt to get Ahlul Sunnah close to the authentic Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I mean, this kind of complex that we have, I don't understand. In the Arab world especially, everything is blamed on Israel and the Jews. Why do you fail in school, Israel and the Jews? Why do you feel, okay, fine, I'm not saying they're innocent. But everything now, we have a scapegoat, boom, everything is there, everything is there. This is not about they and her and she and he. And this is about you and the Qur'an and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why do you memorize, I have left among you the Qur'an and Sunnah, and you don't, which is weak, and you don't memorize, I have left among you the Qur'an and Ahlul Bayt, which is strong and sahih and sahih Muslim? Why? Why don't we name Masajid Masjid Imam Hussein? Isn't Ahlul Sunnah wa Jama'ah, aren't we Ahlul Sunnah wa Jama'ah more worthy of following Ahlul Bayt? But these are signs. And these are signs that are attributed to two things. Either jahil, ignorance, or nifaq. No one has anything. No one, his heart does not open to the seerah of Ahlul Bayt except munafiq or jahil. Munafiq, of course. And Hadith Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَمَنْ أَبْغَضَهُمْ فَبِبُغْضِي. But no, this, why do we, why? The reason we don't want to talk about it, dear brothers and sisters, especially about the seerah of Imam Hussein, and Hassan, and Zayd, and Yahya ibn Zayd, and Muhammad ibn Abdullah, etc., etc., because this will create awareness and people will start asking questions, why, and how, and where did you get this from, and then we'll start having accountability. We don't want to have accountability, we want things loose. So everyone, alhamdulillah, everything is great. Huh? And Imam Zain al-Abidin opened his eyes to situations like that. two options. Either he goes to Medina, and he says, my father was slaughtered, my family was slaughtered, that's it, what do you want me to do? Or no, he stands to his responsibilities. He stands to the responsibility of increasing awareness among the ummah, of sending, of giving the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of showing the people the right pathway to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to follow the book and sunnah. This was an obligation upon him. And that's exactly what he did. So you won't go wrong. Of course, three things that happened during the time of Imam Zain al-Abidin. But before this, I'm going to take you back to the day of 10th, fi Ashura, the same day Ashura. And remember, I told you, maybe the last khutbah, the khutbah before, when we first started talking about the seerah of Imam Hussein, that Imam Hussein came the last time to the 10th and saw Zain al-Abidin. Do you remember that? And he saw Zain al-Abidin, and then Zain al-Abidin talked to him. He said, oh father, who is left? And then Imam Hussein told him, there's no one left but me and you. And then he stepped out. Imam Hussein stepped out. That's where we left off. This is what happened. And take this picture. In the day of 10th. And he noticed Imam Zain al-Abidin, as you all know, was very sick. During that time, was unconscious most of the time. He calls, once his father stepped out of the tent, he calls his aunt, Amma Zainab. Aunt Zainab. She comes, yes, what do you want? He says, Amma, give me a sword and a stick. Sick, fever. What do you want to do with the sword and the stick? He said, the sword so I can fight for the deen of my father, and the stick so it can help me walk. She couldn't say anything. Determined, adamant about this. She gave him, أَخَذَتَ السَّيْفَ وَالْعَصَى دَفَعَتُهُمَا إِلَيْهِ. Gave it to him. He took a safe with one hand and the stick in the other hand, got out of the little carpet that he had lying on and started walking. Stepped out of the tent, and Imam al-Hussein noticed him, said, go back to the tent. Jihad, you're not obligated with jihad. And jihad is for he who can, not for he who is sick. Go. And this thing really happened, qadran maqdura. This is really qadr from Allah. Of course, everything is qadr from Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserved the offspring of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Of course, and I'll take you also a little bit further. And remember when Imam Hussein left and talked to Zainab the last time before he was slaughtered, he told the women, اِدْنِينَ عَلَيْكُنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِي بِكُنَّ. That's the last thing he said, basically. Basically telling all the women, because among the women were who? Were the wives of Imam Hussein, of Imam Hassan, Muslim bin Aqil, bin Abi Talib, so many other women. So he told them, cover yourself fully. He's leaving the last time. He said, take your cover fully. اِدْنِينَ عَلَيْكُنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِي بِكُنَّ. Cover yourself. They knew then, they knew what was going to happen. Because they're going to burn the tents, and they're going to get them, and they're going to strap them into pieces. That's exactly what they did. After Imam Hussein was killed, we're not going to go through this, because really, I don't want to go through the slaughtering of Imam Hussein. This is something that my heart cannot take, really, on the minbar. But after the murder of Imam Hussein, they took, of course, they went, they burned the tents, and they went to the daughters of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The daughters of Imam Hussein, Zainab al-Kubra among them, and Sukayna bint al-Hussein, Fatima bint al-Hussein, so many. And they put the chains around three areas. That's the way they used to do with criminals back then. They chain you to the camel with your neck, with your hands, and with your feet. It's called al-Jami'ah. Al-Jami'ah, Sumiyat Jami'ah, because it collects the neck, the hands, and the feet with what? With following the camel. They did that to every single one of the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Behind the camels, of course, at the beginning there were the heads. Al-Imam Hussein's head, Al-Abbas ibn Ali, Umar ibn Ali, Abu Bakr ibn Ali, Uthman ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib, Muslim bin Awsajah, Zuhair ibn Qayn,
أنس بن حنيفة الكهلي الصحابي رضي الله عنه.
So many.
All the 72 heads went on the spears first, and then followed by what? Followed by all the now the prisoners of wars. Who are these prisoners of wars? They are the liver of Rasulullah. They are the heart of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فلذلك كبد المصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم. I'll take you to a stand where النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم goes to the house of Fatima رضي الله تعالى عنها وارضاها, and he hears Hussein crying when he was like four years old. He says, "Ya Fatima, don't you know that crying of Hussein hurts me? Take care of him." What Rasulullah would have done if he had seen this. Anyway, the trip was what? The trip was designed to be humiliating.
Humiliating to do what?
Because the media, the Umawi media, الأواقع الإعلامية الأموية المرتزقة, the mercenary media of Bani Umayya, had changed everything. They told them, these people, أهل بيت رسول الله, أهل بيت العصمة والطهارة, أهل بيت النبوة. What happened to them? They are Khawarij. They are Khawarij. الخليفة الصحيح يزيد بن معاوية, and these people, they're trying to rebel against him. So that's why, look what happens to them. They didn't mention who they are. Just Khawarij. Huh? Like today, anyone who says anything, we call them Shia. We call them Khawarij. لأن الاتهامات, labels and accusations, it's very cheap, they're very cheap. On those who don't fear Allah, everything is cheap. حتى الكفر is cheap to them. No problem. من لم يتق الله فليفعل ما شاء. He can do anything. Don't. فلا يحزنك قولهم. Allah tells the Prophet, إنا نعلم ما يسرون وما يعلنون. Don't be sad for what they said. The convoy of Imam Zain al-Abidin with the head of Imam Hussein and all the daughters of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Ahl al-Bayt were going from city to city, from Kufa to Basra to al-Sham. Their final destination is where? Is Damascus, al-Sham, where the palace, to the palace of Yazid ibn Muawiyah. Let me back now go back to Zain al-Abidin and his accomplishments, because really going through these events is very emotional, and I'd rather not go into there now. We want to learn lessons. We want to learn how to be affected, how to move, how to change. Three revolutions. Don't think that Bani Umayya thought, Yazid thought he killed al-Husayn, and that's it. Al-Haq, he killed al-Haq with him. Nobody's going to say anything now that he showed them that he's even willing to kill Ibn Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nobody can stand against him. He thought wrong again, remember? I told you before, فعلمت أنك نائر ما تبتغي حتما وإن يك سلوك المقدود ظنوا بأن قتل الحسين يزيدهم لكنما قتل الحسين يزيد. They thought that Hussein, that Yazid killed Hussein. The other way around. Matter of fact, Hussein killed Yazid. How did he kill him? Look at this. Zain al-Abidin, through the efforts of Zain al-Abidin, three revolutions erupted. Three revolutions. Number one, ثورة التوابين في الكوفة. Those people, the Tawabin, the repenters. What happened to those people? Those are the people who wrote letters. Huh? Come, we'll support you. All of a sudden, after the killing, they repented. Alhamdulillah, fine. They repented and they formed an army and they went and fought. All of them did not come back. They gave a promise that they will not come back alive, no matter what. And they put a few thousand people, they went and fought the armies of Yazid, and no one of them came back alive. They all were martyred. That's the first revolution. The second revolution, ثورة المختار بن أبي عبيدة الثقفي. المختار بن أبي عبيدة الثقفي went and took a list of everyone who was with the army of Yazid. Every single one. Huh? Yeah, not almost all of them, but most of them that were available. And he followed them one by one and killed them. سلمت يدا. May Allah bless his hands. And among them, Amr ibn Sa'd. وشمر اللعين. Shimr bin Dirjawshan. The Shimr was also, his head was done to him just like he did with the head of the son of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay. The third revolution also, what happened? Thawrat al-Madina. Ahl al-Madina thawru. The people of Medina, they were also, the revolution erupted. Abdullah bin Hanzala al-Ghasil. Hanzala, the Sahabi radiallahu anhu, that was what? Ghasil al-Malaika. He was given the title of what? The Malaika washed him. Remember him? Because he didn't have time. He said, no, I don't have time now to wash. I'll go to jihad.
And he went to jihad without having a ghusl. What happened? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَالْمَلَائِكَ دَوْهُ وَالْمَلَائِكَ عَلَىٰ كِبْنَ الْغُسْلِ. Abdullah ibn Hanzala, his son, was available in Medina at that time, in the year 61 of Hijrah. And he said, Wallahi, we did not erupt. We did not revolt and form a revolution against Yazid ibn Muawiyah until we believed that the sky will come with hijara min sijjin on us. There's no other, what can you do? Three revolutions, and of course, you all know what happened to Bulharra. He sent them the army with Muslim bin Aqaba. Don't say Muslim bin Aqaba, really. I don't believe he's worthy of that. May Allah help. You're all Ahl Medina. يعبث بأعراض المسلمين. الحاكم, the dignity and the honor of Muslims is very high here, brothers and sisters. And الحاكم, the ruler, should do what? Should preserve the honor of Muslims. Should preserve the dignity of Muslims. Should preserve the protection of Muslims. If he changes, it becomes a vicious animal against them. Then nothing remains. Two more revolutions happened after his murder of Imam Zayn al-Abidin. Revolution of Imam Zayd ibn Ali. Zayd, the son of Zayn al-Abidin. Zayd, وما أدراك ما زيد. Zayd, Imam Zayd, he was this man of nur. Yeah, they used to say that when he walks, the nur comes out of his face like the snow. Though they haven't seen the snow, they would say, أبيعوا أبيضوا من الثلج. His nur, mashallah. The son of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he took the sword and Imam Zayd fought. And until they killed him, he was killed. And this is what they did. They crucified him 4 years fil Kufa. 4 years, the body of Zayd ibn Ali, ibn al-Husayn, and Fatima bint Rasulullah was crucified on the cross at Kufa until birds started building their nests on him. Zayd, we'll talk sometime about Zayd, some other time. And then after Zayd, Yahya ibn Zayd, wa Isa ibn Yahya ibn Zayd. Yahya ibn Zayd, what did they do to him? The same thing. Anyone who says the truth is going to follow him. They went against him. After he formed the war and fought them, they went against him. They killed him and they crucified him. Then what they did after crucifixion of Yahya ibn Zayd, radwanullahi ta'ala alayh, they put him and burnt him. And they took his ashes and they threw him all over the place. Throw him everywhere you want. Zayd wa Yahya ibn Zayd in our hearts are living. In our minds are living. So you throw them away, throw them. And you burn them, burn them. You kill the body, but you never kill the ideology. You kill the body and you cut the head, but you never cut the haqq. Al-haqq is always there. And al-haqq will always be there. And al-haqq is always, you let it into the Zalim cannot take al-haqq because it shakes him. Therefore, Hisham bin Abdul Malik, as you all know, one time when he goes, Bani Umayyah, when they used to go to Hajj, the Hukam, Bani Umayyah, the Umara, they would take, of course, thousands of people, the entourage. The entourage has to go with the servants, and رضي الله عنه, Abi Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali. When the Rasul of Kisra came to Sayyidina Umar, and Umar was sleeping on the tree with nobody. Now, just to go to Hajj, you have an entourage, just like today. Why? Your fear? You're scared about your life. Why are you scared? Because you're zalim. Okay. Hisham ibn Abdul comes to the Hajj, the day of Hajj. People everywhere. He tries to get to the black stone, Hajar al-Aswad. He doesn't get to it. Too many people. Too many people sitting. And millions of people at that time. It was a lot of people. And people, everybody wants to get to Hajj, just like today. So what he ordered, Hisham ibn Abdul Malik, Amir, and he has all these ministers with him, and all these generals, and all these soldiers, and weapons, and everything. Put me something up, like a big chair, like a stadium, so I can sit and watch everybody. And with me, of course, you have food and everything, and of course you have the royal treatment in Hajj. Different, because classification, tabaqiyya. And while they're sitting, because they couldn't get to the Hajj al-Aswad, all of a sudden comes Zayn al-Abidin. Enters the Haram al-Makki al-Sharif. When he enters the Haram, the people that were there, they saw him and they knew who he was. They opened up the way for him just like a river would open, all the way until he went to the Hajar al-Aswad. The people who came with Hisham ibn Malik,
from Sham and other places. They don't know because he told them the Khawarij and all these things. One of the so appears to be generals or close to Yazid, to Hisham, he told them, who is this? We tried to go and we couldn't. Who is this? Hisham told him, I don't know. Well, he knows who he is. But he doesn't want to tell him why. Because he doesn't want to tell him this is Zayn al-Abidin, Ibn al-Husayn, that we, Fatima, all these things. No. Al-Farazdaq, the poet, was sitting. Farazdaq Tamimi, from Bayt Tamim. Was sitting close on the same kind of, because you know how the old days, the rulers always had all these poets to give them, what? To praise them and they get money for that. This is called media. This was the media. The poets were the media. You pay the media and they say whatever you want. No problem. But Al-Farazdaq had this moment of truth, I believe, where he told the minister who came with Hisham, said, I know him. I know him. You know, somebody sometimes says, I know him. He says, who is he? Now Hisham started, what is he going to say? And he said a few things. Some long qasida, but I mentioned a few. He said, هذا الذي تعرف البطحاء وطاته والبيت يعرفه والحل والحرم هذا ابن خير خلق الله كلهم هذا النقي التقي الطاهر العلم إذا رأته قريش قال قائلها إلى بيت هذا ينتهي الكرم يقضي حيان ويقضى من مهابته فما يكلم إلا حين يبتسم ينشق نور الهدى من نور طلعته كالشمس ينجاب عن إشراقها القتم مشتقة من رسول الله نبعته طابت عناصره والخيم والقيم هذا ابن فاطمة إن كنت جاهله بجده أنبياء الله قد ختموا وليس قولك من هذا بظاهره العرب تعرف من أنكر والعجم الله شرفه قدما وعظمه جرى بذاك له في لوحه القلم من محشر حبهم دين وبغضهم كفر وقربهم منجى ومعتصم إن عدت أهل التقى كانوا أئمتهم وإن قيل من خير أهل الأرض قيل هم الغيوث إذا ما أزمة أزمت والأسد أسد الشرى والبأس محتدم لا يستطيع جواد بعد غايتهم ولا يدانيهم قوم وإن كرموا ما قال لقط إلا في تشهده لولا التشهد كانت لاؤه نعم. I can't explain all these things really. Those of you who are disadvantaged in the Arabic language. It's a moment of truth, subhanAllah, when al-haq comes. When al-haq comes, when the light is turned on, what happens to darkness? Disappears. He said to him roughly, this is who al-Baqa knows, the earth of Mecca. The ground of Mecca knows his steps. تعرف وقته. Al-Baqa تعرف who he's walking on it. If you don't know, the earth knows who's walking on it. والبيت يعرفه. البيت knows him. مكة, الكعبة. والحل والحرام. الحرام, everyone knows him. The stones know him. Is what he's telling him. هذا ابن خير خلق الله. This is the son of the best of the creation. And then he starts telling him, you can see the nur of Rasulullah coming out of his face. You can't, isn't that enough for you to know who he is? هذا ابن فاطمة, if you say, he's telling who? He's telling Hisham. If you say you don't know him, I'll tell you who he is. He is the son of Fatima. With his grandfather, the Anbiya were sealed. Allahu sharrafah. And if you say, Allah honored him. And if you say you don't know him, وليس قولك من هذا بظاهره, it does not hurt him. You not knowing him does not hurt him. العرب تعرف من أنكر والعجم. Everyone knows who he is. من معشره. From a people whose love is حبهم دينون, that you have this religion to love them, وبغضهم كفر, and hating them is كفر والعياذ بالله. And then he told them, he never said no. If you ask him about anything, he will never say no. ما قال لا قط إلا في تشهده. Only when he لا, he never says that. Except when he does تشهد. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. That's the only time he says لا. ما قال لا قط إلا في تشهده. If it wasn't for the تشهد, his la would have been na'am. Alhamdulillah.
لله حمدا كثيرا ثناء ما واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له ارغاما لمن جحد به وكفر واشهد ان سيدنا مولانا محمد صلى الله عليه واله وسلم خاتم الانبياء المعتمد صلى الله وسلم وبارك على هذا النبي وعلى اله وصحبه ونظر اليه اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى ال سيدنا محمد كما صليت على ابراهيم وعلى ابراهيم ان شاء الله we will continue I thought I would finish it today but we will continue ان شاء الله with the seerah of Imam Zain al-Abidin next time if Allah gives us time and effort again our intention and our thought is to learn from these leaders of Ahl al-Sunnah wal Jama'ah because Ahl al-Bayt they are the leaders of Ahl al-Sunnah wal Jama'ah So we can know why and we can learn from them. So we know what happened through them. So we can learn from history. Some people think that history should not be talked about. Then why do we talk about Musa and Fir'aun? Why do we talk about Ibrahim and Namrud? We have to learn. Al-Quran, one third of the Quran is about what happened. So we can find ways to avoid what was wrong and to do what was right. Our intention is not to dehumanize people, certain people, regardless how evil we think they committed. That's not the intention. The intention is to learn from the mistakes and so we can avoid them and to learn from the correct things so we can do them. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ali Ibrahim. Barak ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. Kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ali Ibrahim. Fil alayna innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma nasur al-Islam wa al-Muslimin. Wa a'li ya maulana kalimata al-haq wa al-deen. Allahumma man arada bil-Islam wa al-Muslimin khayran fawafiqhu ilayh. Wa man arada bihim ghayra dhalika faj'al da'irata as-sawi alayh. Allahumma rudd al-Muslimin ila deenika raddan jameela. آتي أنفسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ربنا ومولاها اللهم عرفنا بالسنة اللهم علمنا السنة اللهم اجعلنا ممن يتبع السنة اللهم اجعلنا من أهل السنة اللهم أحينا على السنة اللهم أمتنا على السنة اللهم احشرنا على السنة اللهم صلي على صاحب السنة فل لهم لنا ولآبائنا ولمشايخنا ولمن له حق علينا ولمن على الخير أعاننا ولمن على الشر أبعدنا ولمن أوصانا بالدعاء وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وآله أقيم الصلاة
even the, because they're everything materialistic is all over their life and then Muslims are also a need for the da'wah and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم gave da'wah to people first for 13 years as you all know before zakat and siyam and salam and all these things in hajj The sister asks, do you know anyone that teaches tajweed, independent tutor for males? Contact brother Omar, inshallah, and he will let you know. No.
One question.
No.
Is there a difference between tabligh and da'wah? The terms, are they just used?
Is there a difference between tabligh and da'wah? At tabligh, huwa
naql. كأنه يأخذ أمانة ينقلها يبلغها هو نقل نص الدعوة مفهوم أعم مفهوم أوسع لذلك نجد أن الله سبحانه وتعالى كرر مفهوم الدعوة أكثر في القرآن
تبليغ is just delivering the message While da'wah is much more comprehensive, so one is a little narrow. It could be delivering anything, and one is more comprehensive. Shall I see you to do? Sallallahu sallam alayhi wa sallam.
Huh?
مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك
حيث الخلق
صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق
اللهم رحمتك نرجو فلا تكلنا إلى أنفسنا طرفة عين وأصلح لنا شأننا كله لا إله إلا أنت اللهم إنا نسأل رحمتك وعزائي ومغفرتك والغنيمة من كل بر والسلامة من كل اسم والفوز بالجنة والنجاة من النار. لا تدع لنا يا مولانا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا ضرا إلا كشفته ولا مبتلا إلا عافيته ولا مريضا إلا شفيته ولا حاجة لك فيها رضا إلا قضيتها برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم لا تدع فينا شقيا ولا مطرودا ولا محروما. اللهم وسع علينا وعلى سكان هذه البلاد بالإيمان والأنوار. اللهم اجعلنا رحمة للعالمين. اللهم اجعلنا رحمة للعالمين. اللهم اجعلنا رحمة للعالمين. اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا واجعلنا سببا لمن اهتدى. اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مرحوما وفرقنا من بعده فرقا معصوما. ولا تدع فينا شقيا ولا مطرودا ولا محروما. اغفر اللهم لنا ولوالدينا ولمشايخنا ولأرباب الحقوق علينا ولجميع المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات. إنك يا مولانا سميع قريب مجيب للدعوات. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد عبدك ورسولك النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. ربنا تقبل منا وقلنا بسر الفاتحة.
I think there is some food, inshallah, for those of you, after food for the soul, food for the body now. Yeah.